Hi, I'm Brian Holt. I'm a VP of product at SQLite Cloud. Since I taught the first version of this course, containers have only become more important. In this course, we'll talk about crafting containers by hand, Docker and Docker files, making secure and fast containers, and even container orchestration with Kubernetes. Containers are powerful and useful and more simple than you think. This course will give you the confidence to work with them.
This is essentially the most basic Node app you can ever build. There's no dependencies. There's not even anything to npm install here, right? So now I have a index.js. How do I get this into my container, right? Because right now, if I just build this again, there's nothing in there that's referencing it, right? So I have to put a copy statement in here. I have to say copy index.js. I have to tell it where it's coming from. So in this particular case, it's coming from this particular directory I'm in, and I'm telling it where to put it. Now I could say dot, right, which would just say put it here, or I can just say index.js. And then here, I'm just going to put index.js. Okay, let's build her. So Docker build, we'll just call this version 3, because why not? And you can see it's doing a bit more up here now, right? It copied some files. Look at that. So now I'm going to say Docker run my Node app 3. And now it's running a server. Now notice if I go back to my index.js here, I say listen on port 3000. One would reasonably expect that I could go to localhost 3000 and that it would work, but it doesn't. Why? Well, I have a container that's running that's listening on port 3000, but by default, containers don't expose any of their ports. It's generally a good thing, right? It's a security vulnerability otherwise. So how do we get it to expose that port 3000 to the outside consumer? We have to publish it. So I'm going to stop my server here. I guess this is another annoyance of Docker. So you notice here I just did Control C and it's not doing anything. Is because I didn't tell it how to shut down. So I actually have to go say Docker kill. What, I don't even remember what I called it. Docker PS. Docker kill Zenborg. Yours is probably going to be something else, right? Yeah. So that killed it. And I'm now going to say Docker run. In order to get around that issue of not being able to control C to get out of it, you can do dash dash init, and that will allow you to control C out of it. That's very helpful for this. Normally, what you should do if you're like doing this with like Node.js or something like that, you should just handle that sig term interrupt directly in your code, or use some package that does it for you. Dash dash init is Docker basically saying like, I give up, I don't want to handle this stuff, handle it for me. But it is a blunt instrument. So it's literally just going to just cut the entire process off and chuck it out. Normally, processes like to be like wound down, let them finish whatever they're doing, let them sync out their logs, and then shut down gracefully. Just good to know. But I use dash dash init all the time because normally I don't care. All right, dash dash publish. Or if you are lazy, like I am, you can just do dash P. And then you have 3000 colon 3000. One of those is the source port, and one of them is the destination port. So you can't just do publish 3000. You have to do 3000 colon 3000. But let's say you had it running on port 80, and you wanted to export it on port 8080 or something like that. You could do some fun mapping that way. The first one represents the host machine. The second one represents what port is being used in the container, which is always the opposite of what I expected. So I have to remember that whatever I think is wrong. In any case, they're the same, doesn't matter. And we're gonna do it for my Node app. Let's give it a name as well so I don't have to remember it. Oh, and I need a colon 3 because I gave it a tag. Okay, server started, it's running. And now if I go into here and I refresh the page, you can see it is actually exposing our Node app outside. You're gonna apply everything you just learned here, and whoever makes the smallest container wins. No, I'm just kidding, that's a joke. you can do this however you want to, but I'm gonna have you build an Astro project. And I had it built with Astro and React and TypeScript and Tailwind. And the reason why I'm doing that is I'm not actually using any of them in the project. I just wanted you to have a bunch of dependencies to install. Okay. And you can either start from like an npx create Astro at latest on your local development environment, or you can just use my copy of it. I added Tailwind and React to it, but you don't have to. It effectively ends up being the same thing. But here's what I want you to do. I want you to have a multi-stage build where you're going to take your Astro project, you're going to build it, and then you're going to copy it into an Nginx container, and that Nginx container is then going to run your project for you, right? It's going to distribute it, right? Because think about an Astro project, once you build it, is just static assets, right? It's HTML, it's CSS, it's JavaScript, it's images. There's nothing dynamic or server or Node-y about what's being distributed to the public, right? So in your production container, you don't want Node, for example, right? So what you're going to do is you're going to have a build container that is going to have Node in it. It's going to build the project. It's going to copy that all over into a very special directory inside of Nginx that Nginx is then going to serve for you. So I'm going to create a new file here. Surprise, surprise, we are going to call it Dockerfile. Okay. And let's grab a builder. So from node colon 20 as, by the way, you do not have to make this all caps. I just do out of pure habit. In fact, I see people all the time that don't. I just wanted to disclaim that. As node builder, workdir slash app, copy dot dot. We want everything. We want to run npm ci and then run npm run build. No, build. Thank you. Say, so far, so good, right? Copying everything across. You might say, like, well, why don't you split out, like, your npm, your package part, and your, and the reason why I say is, like, you're going to run build at the end of this anyway, which is probably the longer step anyway. And also, I'm not really optimizing here for the development experience, so. You could totally separate these steps out again if you wanted to. Okay, from, I'm going to say Nginx, let's just say Alpine for fun. I think I have latest in my notes, but either way works. And then we're going to say copy dash dash from, and we're going to say dash node builder and app slash dist. And that is the dangers of relying on Copilot, because it would have been wrong in that particular case. You need to go from dist, because that's by default where Astro builds it. And then you're going to copy that to user share nginx html. That should be about it. Let's give her a build, see what happens. So docker build dash t, we'll call this, like, I don't know, my static app. See what happens when we try and do that. Did I exclude the Docker? No, so you probably would want to do a Docker ignore here. I did not do that, which means I copied my entire node modules across. But let's see if that works. Docker run-it-p. This is by default runs on port 80. So we're going to map port 80 to port 8080. And name, call it my app because I'm uncreative, --rm --init. And my static app. Okay. Looks like we are up and running here. Let's see if we can go to localhost 8080. I guess I can just refresh the page here. Welcome to Astro. Let's go ahead and do a project. It's going to be heavily based on what we did before with like the adding files to a Mongo database and the volumes project that we did, very similar to something like that. So now we're going to be using Docker Compose to manage the Mongo database and the networking. And we're also going to add a front end using React, Parcel, and then Nginx ultimately to solve it. So we'll have three services, an API, the web front end service, and the database service. This index file, it's a slightly modified version of that Mongo app that we were looking at before. One of the things is we did add cores because we're going to be listening on two different ports, and Firefox and Chrome don't like that. You get cores errors when you do that. But beyond that, I think this is almost exactly the same. Okay. Same package.json, except we added a cores handler for Fastify. So that's the API service, nothing interesting there. And then the web service, you can see this is just a Parcel project built with React and React DOM. Okay. There's a little Docker file here. That just it's a two-stage build. It builds it in Node, and then it serves it from Nginx. So nothing too interesting there. There's an index file. There's a style file. And there's a web.jsx file. And this is just a little React app that has a button that every time you click the button, it calls the API. And then it gets back from the API whatever, however many items are in the database. OK, so that is all of the code that we're doing. I even committed the dist directory for you so that you don't actually have to go and build the project yourself. But if you wanted to, all you do is npm run build. That's it. OK. So let's talk about Docker Compose now. We now have three services in here. As you might imagine, a service is like a, you know, like microservices, like the thing that Netflix cursed us all with. That's what all of this is. We have API, which is going to be that API service that we talked to about. The build API, that's referring to this is coming from the API directory. So if I ask Docker Compose to build my project for me, it knows where to find the Docker file, which is going to be in the API directory. I'm telling it to expose ports 8080 and make them available locally for me. So if I want to call the API directly, I can. And it's saying links DB. This is basically just saying that it talks to the DB service on the network. So make that available to the API service. And then we're giving it the environmental variable of how to connect to Mongo. The database service is really just like, hey, just run Mongo 7 directly off of Docker Hub, no modifications. That's all that does. And then the web director service, build from web. This is the API URL and the ports. Nginx by default exposes port 80, but we want to make it available on port 8081. Yeah, question.
I assume there's an applied network created for these containers just by using Docker Compose.
Which Docker Compose totally manages for you.
Why is there no links from the web to the API?
Because it's all done through your browser, right? So the Nginx container is not speaking to the API, right? Nginx doesn't call the API. Your browser calls the API. So we have to expose this because your front-end client is going to call API 8080, right? But if they did, right, let's say if you had some sort of heartbeat or something like that, you would have to do that, right? But there's no network traffic between the two of them. I guess that's the sum of the story. whereas these two do have network traffic between each other. So let's run it, right? We're going to come into our CLI. And I'm going to say docker compose up dash dash build. So you can see web one, this is all the logs coming from Nginx, right? Web being the name of the container that we called it, right? And dash one being the first replica of there, because you can actually tell it's like, hey, please run 10 of these for me, or run 100 of these for me. We're just telling it to say run one of each at the moment. We have DB1, as you might imagine, that's the Mongo one that's taken care of. And then somewhere down here, we have API, which I'm sure will be somewhere, maybe. Well, I'm sure if we make a request to it, localhost 8081. Yeah, right there, API. I have this attached to Avon, so I've been running this for a little bit already. That's why I have 14 counts in here. But if I click add, it should add new things to my database.